Hey there, my name is Cameron, better known as Venus Theory, and welcome back to the Cubase YouTube channel. In this video, we're here to continue on with the series all about creating modern electronic music inside of Cubase. In part one, we talked about some basic ideas to help you get inspired, get things started, and lay down the groundwork and the bare bones of your track to hopefully set yourself up for success in your writing session. If you haven't watched part one, you can pause this video now, go check it out, and come back once you're all caught up. In this video, we're going to be exploring the topic of arrangement and taking that initial idea and that initial loop and fleshing it out and turning it into a full track. Here we are back in the fun zone, or the danger zone, however you prefer to think of it, with the session now that it has been arranged. Once again, for the sake of time, we're not going to be doing this from scratch, but rather I wanted to walk you through the order of operations, a couple of tips and ideas, and just my thought process along the way to take the track from a loop to a finished idea. Right up front, I think the main takeaway from this video, if all else, is duplicate and variate. And this is an idea that was given to me by one of my own mentors. And really, if you think about it, duplicate and variate is everywhere in music. It is long-standing the most common and straightforward way of arranging a track, whether we're talking Motown or country or modern electronic music or whatever it is you're making. Duplicate and variate will save you so much time and so much energy when it comes to actually finishing an idea. In part one, I actually touched a little bit on this by taking the drop that I wrote and turning it into an intro just to start the session off and get the song flowing. You know, we've got an intro, here's the song, and it's going to lead into this drop. So from there, it was a matter of just simply expanding on it. Scrolling over here, if we mute this vocal, this is the main drop we had in part one. Now, this track, I knew I wanted an intro, I wanted a drop, we needed to then release some of that energy with a midsection, which is pretty standard in these styles, and then we need to build back up and go through a B drop and then an outro, or just let the track kind of stop. So I had a rough sketch in mind of where I wanted to go and when I wanted to go there. Turning this A drop into something more interesting wasn't really all that hard. What I did is just duplicate it out here and then delete most of the instruments and start building it up piece by piece. In the intro, I started off with a different melody than the main drop. So the main drop, we've got this synth going on. And in the intro, I've got this. So I figured, why not sort of do, I guess, a half drop to lead up to the big main drop. In this half drop here, I took the intro melody and applied that to my main lead and that lead layer that I created. I also applied it to that blip lead. So we've got a bit of pacing and build up from that blip lead here in the intro, which is just that little rhythmic thing. By applying that same melody from the intro to the blip lead, it slows things down. You know, we've built up that tension, we've gone through that anticipation that the drop is about to kick in, so now we're gonna back off the gas a little bit before going back in and stomping everybody's faces in. I took the 808 pattern, brought that back as well, and I just got rid of the brass because I've already used that. We don't wanna drop everything at once. There's a lot to be said by addition, by subtraction. Within the drums here as well, I took the drums from the main drop and simply started deleting things and adding things in slowly. So it starts off just kick and snare, then I bring in this first hat layer, and then I bring in the other hat layer in the second half, and then I just utilize the transitions to indicate when something new is going to happen or change. That gives us the buildup into the first kind of half drop, which altogether sounds like this. So it feels pretty big, it feels pretty heavy, but it's not quite there yet. To then start building anticipation for the main drop, I took the blip lead and started bringing that in, and then I bring the brass in here in the second section alongside the first hi-hat layer. So listen to the subtle difference that this applies to this half drop. So we're getting there. And we're gonna pull back. And now we're all in. There's a lot to be said in stopping stuff, because I feel like, especially in modern electronic music, it's so much about the bass and the low end and these huge screaming synth lines and everything being super loud and in your face all the time. So you need to provide little breathers and micro contrast moments to keep the listener engaged and prevent a lot of fatigue. Zooming in here, what I did is simply one bar and a couple of beats completely start to kill everything off and created a little drum fill, not by doing anything fancy, but by taking the existing drums and arranging the snare hits into a little bit of a fill. To provide a bit of contrast and callback, I also brought in that vocal sample that's in the intro, so this way we're kind of tying these different themes and ideas together. That way, we're keeping things full, we're keeping things engaged, we're calling back to different elements, letting the listener know that we're progressing, and I think you get the general idea. Halfway through the main drop as well, I went in and did a similar trick where I stopped that little blip lead and then had the brass come in on top of this kick. So we're having something similar, but a variation of it. And this is one of the key points, I think, of the idea of duplicate and variate. Although it would be incredibly simple to take this drop, do it for 8 bars, copy it, and paste it in, there's something to be said for adding a subtle change in that second half of everything. So every time you duplicate, add some kind of subtle variation. It doesn't need to be big. You don't need to reach for the moon every single time. You just need to change one or two little things, or maybe take one or two little things away, and you've got a new section that keeps the listener engaged and keeps your song moving forward. So, to add a little bit of duplication and variation, I just changed up the kick rhythm a little bit. I brought in the brass on the downbeat. I stopped the hats here, and then with the risers and everything else, it keeps this from feeling too fatiguing and boring. Just a subtle change, a subtle pause, and a subtle bit of, oh dude, something awesome's about to happen. Now, let's talk about the midsection. This is a critical point in a lot of modern electronic music because typically we have an A drop and a B drop, and maybe even a C and a D drop, depending on what you're doing. So adding a break in between is pretty important because if we just went from the intro to the half drop to the A drop to the B drop and then the C drop and the D drop, there's so much energy there and it really doesn't give you any release. Creating this midsection here was actually incredibly simple. I just copied the intro and pasted it in and then changed a few things. So I once again duplicated and, say it with me now, variated. This was pretty straightforward. I just did a few small changes. I've got the main lead going here with that automation clip. I brought in the blip lead below it just to add a little bit of a different flavor so it's layered up. I've got the blip lead coming in here, building up that anticipation. Then I brought the 808 in here, which isn't in the intro. This provides a bit of weight and interest to this whole section. So we're calling back to the A drop, we're saying, hey, you know, we're building up, we're getting excited again. Without that bass, it just loses a little bit of punch. If we roll back here for the sake of context, it just doesn't sound all that interesting and it doesn't retain enough energy to say like, okay, we're kind of pausing, but we're kind of getting pumped again. Down here in the bottom, I did a few changes to the transitions as well, so I duplicated all the transitions and added a variation. So in the original intro, I layered up this new sound with all these risers. And I figured an interesting way to play off that was to set it back to be the original version, which is going straight forward rather than being reversed. So that layers with these two transitions and creates this. So now we get a downlifter, and then we just reverse that and it becomes a riser. That way we're getting just a subtly different transition. And it just fills things out with a little bit more flavor. Within the build-up phase here, I just did pretty much the identical thing I did in the intro, except I've got the 808s going here, I don't have the brass going, and then I got rid of those extra snare rolls, and this provides just a subtle change once again. And then we move in here to the B drop. There's a lot we can talk about with the art and appreciation of what makes a good B drop or a good B section. It's pretty easy to take a drop that you had, duplicate it over, and just roll around once again, but I think there's a lot more to a good B drop than that. I think it's about changing things up, doing something new, and maybe introducing something that contrasts entirely with the previous sections. To make this B drop and make things more interesting, I brought in an entirely new sound that up until this point has never occurred. This way we're calling things home, we're saying this is the end, this is where it all comes together once again, because that is the purpose of a drop. It is the culmination of everything in a track. And by introducing something new and entirely different, it makes things a bit more interesting to then summarize your track in the latter half of the B drop by calling back to earlier and prior elements, themes, melodies, or samples, or whatever you had earlier on in the track. This sound comes from Halion Sonic here, and it's a layer of two different sounds. I've got one preset from Flux called Lycan here, and then I have another one called Rough Rider. If we listen to these in isolation, it sounds like this. It kind of reminded me of the brass. So this way, I'm calling back in a way to a sort of familiar element, but I'm doing something entirely new with it. The layer Rough Rider sounds like this, which is just a really big, bad FM sort of thing. Layered together, I thought it sounded really, really cool. So again, I'm calling back to a familiar thing, doing something entirely new with it, and adding something unfamiliar and entirely brand new to the track and to the listener. The B section lead melody here is also entirely different and provides a bit of contrast to everything else we've heard up until this point, but everything else remains largely the same. If we look at the structure of the B drop here, you can see once again I did kind of a half drop sort of thing and then bring it back with the full drop. Creating this section, I actually did something super similar. I brought in a very minimal section here with just the kick and the snare. Then I start bringing in these hats. I've got a slightly different drum fill here. I've got a slightly different fill here. Then in the second section, I'm bringing in that blip lead. I'm leaving this new horn lead in. I'm bringing in that brass. And up here at the top, I'm introducing that main lead once again, but I'm using the melody that I'm using at the start of the B drop here. This way, we're tying things together. We're kind of making our closing statements and closing arguments and bringing the track home. So let's take a listen to how these sections evolve over time. Sort of building. Doesn't sound too full though. Here comes a fill. Now we've got everything. Feels super big, super loud. Tension and release once again with a moment of pause. We're building up, we're calling home, and we're done. When it comes to creating contrast and dynamics and interest in your tracks, one of my favorite and I think one of the most powerful arranging tricks is the idea of addition by subtraction. With genres like modern electronic music or super modern heavy metal stuff or modern pop even, we're dealing with a lot of very big upfront sounds, whether it's the pummeling double bass line with huge 8-string guitars or big 808s that are just rocking ultra-low fundamental frequencies, or a dense pop wash of complex synth layers and melodies and vocal harmony interplay and all sorts of stuff. It's very hard to keep things interesting because they have to, in a way, be loud and kind of squashed. I think the best way to fix this is simply by building a big full section and taking things away, because It might sound a little boring on its own, and it might sound a little bit plain, but by adding contrast, by adding in elements once again and taking them away and adding them in and adding little pauses, you can create a lot more interest in your mixes and keep things feeling lively without being too repetitive or just kind of trite. One final thing I want to leave you with to chew on a bit here when it comes to arrangement actually has to do with mixing, and we're going to deal with this more in part three, but I think it's worth talking about a little bit. I'm a very firm believer in the idea that the best tool you have as a mixing engineer is a good arrangement. A solid song that's constructed well makes your life a lot easier later down the line, because if your song is poorly arranged, it can be a nightmare to mix, especially, I think, as one of the bigger amateur mistakes of stuffing in as much stuff as possible all the time, it makes it really hard to mix because you have to give things focus. That's all I got for this one, so thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel down below for updates on all things Cubase and more videos just like this one. And as always, I hope this inspires you to get out there and make something awesome.